Namaskaram everyone. In this video, I shall be discussing the latest IAP guidelines 2022 on global developmental delay. Now see, developmental delay is defined as significant delay, that is, which is less than 2 standard deviations below the mean using standardized tests. And it is defined in children less than 5 years of age. This is very important because the residents most of the times do not know that the term developmental delay is used in children less than 5 years of age, and for children more than 5 years of age, the term which is used is intellectual disability. For developmental delay, you calculate developmental quotient or DQ or social quotient, that is SQ, whereas in more than 5 years of age, that is for intellectual disability, you calculate intellectual quotient or IQ. As per the Indian Academy of Pediatrics, you see the developmental delay in the following 5 domains, that is gross or fine motor, speech or language, cognition, social personal and activities of daily living. This is in contrast with most of the textbooks which mention 4 developmental domains, that is gross motor, fine motor, both of them are separate, speech or language and social personal. Another important thing which you must remember is that children with developmental delay and coexistent psychosocial deprivation should be provided stimulation and reassessed again after 6 to 9 months before being labeled as having global developmental delay. Why? This is because such children, for example, who turn orphan at the time of their birth or whose mother expires soon postnatally, unfortunately, or where there is discordance in the family or extreme poverty, they may show initial delay in these domains. But they might catch up soon with timely introduction of developmentally supportive or tender loving care and with the rectification of the underlying problem. So on the basis of social quotient, as per the Indian Academy of Pediatrics, the severity of global developmental delay can be classified as mild when the SQ is between 55 to 70, moderate when it is between 36 to 54, severe when it is between 21 to 35, and any SQ less than 20 makes the patient fall in the category of profound developmental delay. But the term global shall be used only when the developmental delay is present in at least 2 domains. You must also remember that children whose developmental delay in 2 or more domains can be explained primarily by motor delay, for example prematurity, or severe uncorrected visual or hearing impairment, they may need to be excluded from the diagnostic label of global developmental delay. For example, children who are born deaf and dumb would obviously show some delay even when they are neurologically intact. Why? Because they cannot listen or follow your instructions. So in them, the only faculties by which they are learning are vision, smell and touch. So they shouldn't be called as having global developmental delay unless and until they show delay even after their hearing or speech has been corrected. Now there are 2 things. First is developmental surveillance, which is done using questions specifically related to age-appropriate milestones achieved at that time. And the second thing is developmental screening. This is done using standardized screening tools. So developmental surveillance should be done till 2 years of age every time the child comes for immunization, the routine immunization. And developmental screening should be done in all children at 9 to 12 months of age, between 18 to 24 months of age, and at the time of school entry. In high-risk children, developmental screening using standardized screening tools should be done at 4 to 6 months, 9 to 12 months, 18 to 24 months, and then yearly till 5 years of age and once at the time of school entry. It is also essential to remember that children diagnosed as having global developmental delay should be screened for autistic spectrum disorder, which is becoming increasingly common, especially after the COVID hiatus. And this is done between 18 to 24 months. And if this is negative, then it is repeated again at 3 years of age. The common etiologies seen in the prenatal period are genetic, for example, chromosomal aberrations like trisomy 21, Monogenic disorders, for example, Fragile X syndrome, congenital CNS malformations, inborn errors of metabolism, intrauterine infections, and environmental causes like toxins or teratogens. Perinatal acquired causes like hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, bilirubin encephalopathy, and CNS infections, for example, meningitis. Environmental causes like prematurity or birth trauma. And postnatal acquired causes, for example, hypothyroidism. And environmental causes like brain tumors, infantile tremor syndrome, psychosocial deprivation, nutritional deficiencies, toxins, and post-traumatic. The clinical evaluation of a child with global developmental delay requires taking a detailed history and doing an astute clinical examination for assessment of developmental delay, etiological risk factors as discussed previously, and comorbidities should also be recorded as accurately as possible. But one must remember that a definitive diagnosis of global developmental delay should be based on the results of standardized tests of development. For example, by screening, that is by asking the history of milestones, etc., you can assume that the child is having delay. But unless and until you use the standardized tests of development, you should not label him as having global developmental delay. Investigations for etiology require neuroimaging when specific clinical indicators are present, and in this case an MRI brain is preferred to CT due to better soft tissue delineation, an EEG only if clinical suspicion of epilepsy or epileptic syndromes are there, for example West syndrome, Motahara syndrome, etc. Biochemical and metabolic investigations for identifying treatable conditions causing or associated with global developmental delay. Biotinidase deficiency to be ruled out. Lead levels in patients with risk of environmental exposure. Genetic tests should be done on clinical suspicion of genetic disorder and or in the absence of a clear etiology of developmental delay. CPK should also be done in young boys with unexplained global developmental delay, especially in mitochondrial myopathies. For comorbidities, we need to do a vision and hearing screen, which should preferably be done in all children before subjecting them to standardized tests of development. Thyroid function tests, which might be repeated at regular intervals in children who are at risk, for example, Down syndrome, or have symptoms suggestive of hypothyroidism. And for comorbidities, iron and B12 deficiency should also be evaluated for even in the absence of clinical pointers of this deficiency. Early intervention in the NICU itself with developmentally supportive care is the quintessential thing, and this should be initiated soon after the delay is recognized. For example, in screening itself, instead of waiting for a formal diagnosis with standardized tests of development. Potentially treatable causes should be rapidly identified and specific treatment be initiated as early as possible so that we can prevent neurological injury in the child. Screening for comorbidities and timely appropriate referrals should be done for behavioral problems, epilepsy, cerebral palsy, vision and hearing impairment, and sleep disturbances. For comorbid febrile seizures, EEG is indicated when associated with a family history of epilepsy and or complex febrile seizures, and such patients should be subjected to intermittent prophylaxis. Preschool education services should be provided in the least restrictive environment. The cardinal principle of intervention is early intervention using multiple modalities. Intervention plan should be individualized, keeping in mind the child's functional level in different domains, which might be different in different children with developmental delay of the same age. The immediate next milestone should be aimed to be achieved. Congruent skills to be chosen from multiple domains at a time. Congruent skills, for example, here I've shown in this picture, a 6-month-old child can turn to source of sound when heard. He can also put everything into mouth and has palmar grasp and can remain friendly with strangers. So all these are congruent milestones. All these are achieved at around 6 months of age. So congruent skills should be chosen from multiple domains at a time. Toys and activities should be chosen such that they are difficult enough to be interesting to the child, but easy enough to be played with or accomplished. Parents or other family members should be actively involved in the process and implement strategies at home during daily activities. Also, multidisciplinary intervention might be required, including experts from developmental pediatrics, pediatric neurology, special education, clinical psychology, occupational therapy, physiotherapy, and speech therapy, and ENT specialists. Counseling should be done regards the diagnosis, etiology, anticipated comorbidities, investigations, management, prognosis, and follow-up. And this should be done to parents once at the time of initial diagnosis and again when more etiological information is available or the etiology is finally established. Regular follow-up should be done targeting all the developmental domains and associated comorbidities. So, the follow-up needs to be look for new milestones achieved, any change in previous developmental domain, screen and monitor for anticipated comorbidities, compliance with therapies and side effects if any, growth parameters and head circumference to rule out microcephaly, routine pediatric management like nutrition, immunization, etc., new parental concerns, counseling and advice regarding preschool education, disability certification and government benefits. For more details on a similar topic of cerebral palsy, most of which go hand in hand at many times and which definitely form a long case in pediatric exit exams, you may please check another video of mine, the link of which I have shared in the description box below. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.